Okay, I think we're about ready. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Henry Jackson Society's event on abandoning the far right. Joining me today are two brilliant speakers, Caelan Robinson and Tony McAleer, and I'm going to introduce them briefly in one moment. Just a little bit of housekeeping. If you have any questions, please use the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen that you're watching, and we will put those questions to our speakers towards the end of the programme. So first things first, Tony McAleer, in the 1980s, he was leader of one of Canada's largest neo-Nazi skinhead organisations, the White Aryan Resistance. He was also an organiser for that very group. He ran a computerised racist hotline and was an outspoken Holocaust denier and activist. Since renouncing his far-right views, Tony has authored the book The Cure for Hate and is an international speaker who now uses his work to strive to educate individuals, families, communities and law enforcement on how to deal with white supremacist movements. Tony is co-founder of the nonprofit organization Life After Hate, which seeks to help people leave white supremacist movements behind. We're gonna talk a little bit about Tony's work and his experience throughout the 1980s up until now, and the work he plans to do in the future as we go. Our next speaker is Caelan Robinson. Between 2017 and 2019, Caelan was correspondent for Rebel Media, a director and producer for American far-right radio show host and conspiracy theorist Alex Jones, far-right Canadian political activist Lauren Southern, and British far-right activist Tommy Robinson. During these years, Caelan was also responsible for the production and content of many others for online far right, which included, and he produced videos which included the nightmare of mass immigration and the genocide against the white population. After the far right storming of the Capitol building in Washington, DC, in January of this year, Caelan, alongside a number of other former far right extremists, founded a group called Future Freedom, which hosts an online space for people to talk through their far right views anonymously and share their stories with the ultimate hope of renouncing those extreme ideologies. So I'd like to welcome you both today, Caelan and Tony. Thank you for joining us. We've got a really, really large audience who have joined us here, and I'm really looking forward to our discussion. So first things first, I want to turn first of all to Tony McAleer, if that's okay. Tony, we're grappling with the relatively new issue of far-right extremism, and truthfully it's long overdue that counter-terrorism authorities across the West were looking at the threatened risk of far-right extremism. You got caught up in far-right extremism some years ago. My question is two-pronged. Could you please tell us how that happened, how you got caught up in that far-right movement? And briefly, how you think your experience, if it does at all, differs from the way in which people become drawn into the far-right movements today? Thank you.
Great question. There's a couple nuances to that. I think the reasons people join or are drawn to these organizations hasn't changed a whole lot, but the methodology, the tools, the tactics, the internet obviously changes how that happens. But I think the root vulnerabilities are the same in the far right as they are in ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and other types of extremism. For myself, I was a young man in search of identity, a sense of meaning, I found power when I had felt powerless. I got acceptance when I felt unlovable, and I got attention when I felt invisible. There was stuff that happened in my childhood, and the study of terrorism and responses to terrorism at the University of Maryland did an academic paper, and they found that the number one correlated factor in the history of someone joining a violent extremist group is childhood trauma. And I think it's, what is it about trauma? And it's a thing I call toxic shame, with the feeling of being less than human, not good enough, not pretty enough, not smart enough, not worthy enough. And we can get that without childhood trauma through abandonment, neglect, and things like that. And I think that creates the vulnerabilities by which these groups are very good at drawing people in and filling those gaps that young people have. And There's, you know, very, very few people academically, as to, according to the literature, that are completely radicalized and don't meet another human being. You know, it's just, it's very, very rare. The internet is used as a tool to draw people in, and they'll make you feel special. I just want to be very absolutely crystal clear here. I do not blame anything that anything that I chose to do on my childhood. Everything I did, I chose to do, and I have to take accountability and responsibility for that. But if you, I share those things that happened so that you can understand the lens through which I made those choices. And it's not an excuse. It's rather, it's an understanding. And from that understanding, healing and solutions can be found.
Brilliant. Thank you. I just want to quickly inform the audience, with regards to far-right extremism, there seems to be a spectrum. And I know that counterterrorism policing and security services are really waking up to this now from my own experience in counterterrorism. And it sort of starts at the bottom of the spectrum is the cultural nationalism. And it kind of goes into white nationalism and then white supremacy. Tony, we could be safe to say that you were very much of the far end of the spectrum with the neo-Nazism and the far right, the white supremacy. To be frank, weren't you?
I started at one end and worked my way to the most extreme end. We're at the end. We were stockpiling military weapons or assault weapons and
planning for a race war, which is
absolutely. You know, we considered ourselves white revolutionaries and embraced the swastika and all of those things, but. And I really want to talk about, you know, this whole thing where I talk about shame and childhood trauma. That is really at the root of the really antisocial aspect of the behavior, the violence, the dehumanizing of others. I believe that the level to which we dehumanize other human beings is a mirror reflection of our own internal disconnection and dehumanization and the alienation of the self. I'm not talking about someone who casually agrees with something they read in a pamphlet or sees at a website. That may or may not be the case, but for people motivated to violence, it certainly is a common factor.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. And I think we're going to come back a little bit to talking about those aspects of how people get drawn into radicalization when we talk about how we can potentially de-radicalize people later in this discussion. I want to turn very quickly to Kaylin, if possible. And I want to talk to you, we've talked about that spectrum of cultural nationalism all the way up to, you know, white supremacy. Obviously your experience within the far right was far more recent than Tony's, which was in the 1980s. I would describe certainly from what I've read and spoken to you about, Kaylin, that you were certainly more of the cultural nationalist to the white nationalist sort of side of things. And it'd be really interesting to know how you yourself also found yourself in that far right space. Because, you know, you grew up for all intents and purposes in a multicultural country. And secondly, just on the back of that one, your experience with the far right hasn't only just been within the UK itself. You've also done a lot, and the vast majority of your far right activism was actually Canada and the US. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, firstly, your experience of how you got drawn into it, but secondly, do those movements differ at all from Canada and the US and the UK, or are these very similar sort of things we're looking at?
So I'll go back to the beginning of how I got into all of this stuff. You know, in 2016, it was a highly politicized year. I was someone who was educated, who had just graduated from university, who was living in central London doing marketing. I guess I would have considered myself progressive, but not really engaged in politics. Things around me started to get very, very politically heightened. You had Brexit, you had the rise of Trump, you had a spate of Islamic terror attacks across Europe. You had a Channel 4 documentary called The Jihadi Next Door, where Muslim extremists said that they would throw gay people off buildings. You had a very, very politicized year. And then Orlando happened, where 50 gay people were shot in a nightclub in the US. And at the time, it was the worst mass shooting in the US history. And I remember trying to figure out what happened there. And I didn't grow up watching mainstream media or watching the news. I grew up watching Jeffree Star on MySpace and YouTube. So I typed Orlando shooting into YouTube. All of the top rated results were Rebel Media, were Lauren Southern, it was Milo Yiannopoulos doing a gay kiss off with Gavin McGinnis outside of the Pulse nightclub. And they were talking about how Islam is at war with the West, Islam is at war with the gay community, and Islam is at war with women. And there wasn't any other talk about this. The media didn't do discussions about what ideology led to this sort of stuff happening. It was only happening on the far right. And I really resonated with a lot of that ideology. These weren't, traditional EDL looking people. These weren't like far right people. This was a diverse crowd of people in very polished, very high production value videos, arguing their points and talking about how we need to take care of this issue. A couple of months later, Trump held up a gay flag and he said, "I will protect the LGBT community from the hateful ideology of Islam." Hillary Clinton said nothing. And I went on a bit of a crusade with this, and I really felt like there was a war that was about to take place between Islam and the LGBT community. I started working for Rebel Media and really started becoming someone that was at the heart of all of this stuff. I was recommended videos by YouTube constantly at that time, with more and more right-wing people, more and more far-right people arguing different sort of points. I was recommended a lot of videos about the Great Replacement and how actually it's not about just having these, you know, barbarians come to Europe and eradicate gay rights. It's actually that, you know, white people are going to be replaced in their homelands, and that it will be the end of Europe. And this stuff just became more and more extreme. And it was a very, very, very slippery path. But the whole way, you know, down the line, I was still surrounded with people that would never have fit the mold of, you know, traditional far-right extremists. These were women, educated people, Black people. You know, I was speaking to Candace Owens, who said that the only reason she's with us is because Black Lives Matter are Marxists and they don't make me feel empowered. And it felt safe and it felt normal and it felt like it was okay to have those views, especially that they were so massive on YouTube. These were some of the number one videos of these topics at the time. And as I spent more time watching this, going into an echo chamber, my family distanced themselves from me, my friends distanced themselves from me, and I didn't have any counterpoints to any of this. There was no one telling me these views might be wrong or that they should be questioned. I became more and more involved in this sort of echo chamber, and I really started believing in the Great Replacement theory. I started sympathizing with fascism to deal with this stuff. And these were all videos that were very, very highly recommended on YouTube. And it was a really, really insane time looking back at it. But
So what you're saying in that sense, then the videos you started watching, and then of course you got recommended and you just get sucked further and further into the rabbit hole. It was sort of cross national, you know, it crossed both nations, you know, so it could relate to America as much as it could relate to Europe. So the problem was, it wasn't so much a British problem, it was actually just a cross national problem.
Yeah, I mean the majority of the views and the content coming from this stuff was from the United States, and they were sort of obsessed with this idea of European culture, European heritage, European history. That was the ancestry that carried everyone forward. That's where the great battle was happening. That's where these quote-unquote no-go zones were happening. And that was really at the forefront of all of this, but it was all around this kind of idea of European identity. And it slowly shifted from sort of celebrating European identity to sort of white nationalism and even bordering on white supremacy. I mean, there were people who were my colleagues at Rebel Media who ended up doing podcasts with the Daily Stormer, which openly advocates for terrorism. And so there was a lot of crossovers behind the scenes with this sort of stuff and a lot of acceptance of this sort of stuff. And it just became more and more extreme. And the more time you spend inside of it, you realize that actually at the beginning, you're sucked into a rabbit hole that appears very friendly, nothing to do with hate, nothing to do with anger. And by watching a lot of it, you become more and more involved with more and more hateful people and more radical ideologies. And it wasn't until Christchurch happened, and also that I traveled to Turkey and realized that the people crossing the border to make it to Europe weren't these angry, invading, furious young men. They were women and children, and also young men who genuinely wanted to stay in their home countries, but fled because they had no other choice. I had to actually experience that stuff on the ground to realize that I had been completely wrong about all of this stuff, that my news feeds, which are endless, which everyone looks at, was pumping information that is genuinely wrong, that's genuinely lied, untrue. It was an extremely difficult process. And obviously when Christchurch happened, before that, you really didn't have right-wing terrorism. It was all Islamic. Basically in Britain, it was all Islamic. You had the Westminster attack, London Bridge attack, Manchester Arena attack. You had the attacks in France and all across Europe at the Christmas markets. We never felt like our ideologies of the Great Replacement, ideologies like this stuff, would actually lead to real world violence. It just felt like something that was, you know, pretty open to talk about. But the manifesto of the shooter at Christchurch was called the Great Replacement. It felt really, really close to home. And that's the day that I decided to walk away from all this stuff.
Yeah. That's really interesting. And a question I've got just to follow on from that, and it's to both of you. Tony, if you could possibly answer first, just to give Kaelin a break. I'd be really interested in knowing, whilst you were both involved in the far-right movement, what were the most shocking things you sort of witnessed within that moment, you know, with regards to, you know, tactics on the ground or even recruitment tactics? And was there a particular moment that you really questioned what you were doing? Can you remember that moment where you looked around and thought, this is not great, how far I've got into this? Yeah, that's what I really want to know. You know, the day in, day out, what were some of the worst kind of things you experienced within that group?
Well, you know, I started off as a skinhead in sort of 82, 83, when I was living in England for a short time, for a year. By the time I left, it was 1998, and about halfway between, I stopped wearing bomber jackets and Doc Martens and put on a suit and tie, and became more really of a propagandist. And you know, it's interesting what Kaelin says is, you know, one of the things that is a strategy is called mainstreaming. You know, I still hung out with skinheads, but I wore a suit and tie and came across as reasonable and presentable and articulate. But the links to those that were violent were never more than one or two people away, and could be called upon at any notice. So on the surface going in, you just see the tip of the iceberg, but the iceberg is quite intact. And as a skinhead, we were involved in all kinds of street violence. And then I stopped doing that because it was bad press and all of that. So really what I did was, again, with the phone line, was a propagandist. And anti-Semitism was at the core of what we did. You know, whether it was open door immigration or anything behind it all, was a cabal hive mind of international Jews making it happen. They were the primary enemy. There was no talk of Islam back then. There was talk of another, and it was Jews. And you know, what we really tried to do subtly was to attack their sense of safety, to attack their sense of peace and security where they were existing. And I think that's probably the worst things I did with my writing and with my speech, rather than with the street brawls and in the Holocaust denial. And you know, I couldn't feel my own pain at the time, and I wasn't going to feel anyone else's, and I wasn't going to let them feel their pain. And so Holocaust denial was an important fact of thing that I did that caused a lot of damage.
Behind the scenes, things turned out very, very different to how they were unfolding online. I mean, online, everyone presents a much softer image, you know, with rebel media and with all of these channels. It's about free speech. It's about diversity of thought. It's about everybody coming together and tackling a really out of control left-wing media. And there are a lot of issues with, you know, the left and the media, and with people suppressing nationalism and things like that. But it was all centered around this very, very soft and glowy image. But there were a few moments behind the scenes where I really realized that what was being presented and what actually was being believed behind the scenes was an entirely different process. You know, I remember with Tommy Robinson, we were on stage at Day for Freedom, and this is on public record now. And I genuinely believed in free speech at that time. I genuinely believed at this massive rally with 15,000 people that we just wanted to make a point that free speech is really important. And I invited a Muslim YouTuber to speak on stage, and he was accepted. And then Tommy just turned around and said, well, actually, he's not allowed to speak. I'm worried that he's going to get heckled. And actually, I don't want his voice heard. And I was like, well, why? And it ended up becoming because he's just a Muslim. And actually, he hates Muslims and not just Islam. And also, it happened with Stefan Molyneux when I was making documentaries with him. He had a billion views at the time. He was one of these sort of right-wing philosophers. And he was advocating for white nationalism and race and IQ behind the scenes. And then it peaked. And one of the reasons I really started to walk away was when I was in Milo Yiannopoulos in Miami one day for dinner. And we were talking about tech censorship and the fact that all these right-wingers have been banned off the internet and what we could do about it. And he started advocating for terrorism against people who work at Google and who work at Twitter, so they'd be too terrified to work with these people. These are the things that pushed me to the far right in the beginning. It was Orlando and it was violence. And actually the people propagating this stuff and the people behind the scenes were also pushing and sympathizing with the same thing. So there's a huge disconnect between what people like that put out and what they believe behind the scenes. And I've written about it a lot for Byline Times. I think Lauren Southern is the only person that I worked with that wasn't an extreme radical behind the scenes. It was really shocking to find out.
Thank you. And just a reminder to our viewers that the Q&A function down, we're getting a couple of questions come in now, but make sure you pop your questions down there and I can read them out then later on. Tony, I just want to quickly just go back to you, because I've listened to you quite a lot, and there was a moment specifically when you decided you didn't want to be part of the far right. If you could share that with the viewers, I think it'd be nice to.
Sure. It wasn't, there was a moment that was a catalyst, but it started, that was the beginning of a process. So there was no road to Damascus moment per se, but I found myself in a delivery room at 23, holding this beautiful little baby girl, and she hasn't opened her eyes yet, and she's given a scrunchy face like that, and she opens her eyes, and I connected to another human being for the first time since I couldn't remember when. Up until that point, I was cut off from my heart. I was operating purely from ego and narcissism and attention seeking. And if you'd have met me then, I would have presented as a sociopath. But the birth of my children, because I had a son 15 months later, really started a transformation. It was the beginning of a rehumanizing process for me. And I think, you know, when, and all the people that have helped over the years, and Life After Hate Self, there's always these humanizing moments that are key to that. And with children, it was, they were safe to love, you know, at that age, as young children, they're incapable of shaming, they're incapable of ridicule, they're incapable of rejection. And, you know, the reason we become so emotionally shut off and cut off from our heart is because we learn somewhere along the way that it's not safe to be open, and we put on armor and we put on masks and we put up shields and we project to the world to be something that we're not, so people won't hurt us. But with my children, I was able to let my guard down and I began to see my humanity reflected back at me through their eyes, through their faces. They saw this magnificent, you know, dad who to them was the best person in the world. And that's not who I saw when I looked in the mirror. So it started a healing process, which just became, as I became more humanized, the movement became that much more incompatible. And, you know, I got, you know, my two front teeth knocked out in front of my children when they were, you know, 2 and 4. And that was sort of the last straw, so to speak, by members of my own team. So, you know, on the same side, you know, over some nonsense. And it was just made no sense. And what I ended up being a single father when the kids were 4 and 6. And that gave me the acceptance, attention, approval, and all of those things in a healthy way. And I was able to replace the identity of white supremacist, neo-Nazi, with the identity of single father, because unfortunately in the 1990s, being a single father was like, they were unicorns, and I got all kinds of praise and attention for doing that. And that no woman ever got for being a single mother in the 90s.
Mm. Just obviously you both talked about sort of what happened whilst you were, you know, within these far right movements. I just want to ask a question to Tony again, if possible, because I want to focus now on the work you're both doing, you know, following your work in the far right movement. Obviously, Tony, you work now with Life After Hate, and you've recently wrote a book, Cure for Hate, and that's looking at, you know, a white supremacist, you know, journey through extremism in and out of it. I was wondering if you could talk to the audience about some of the successes you've had with your work with Life After Hate, and whether or not, you know, and how those successes have looked and what kind of people you've come across? You know, do you get a lot of people reaching out to you? And secondly, just off the back of your experience, both in the far right and your subsequent work now with Life After Hate, how do you think we might go about tackling far-right extremism? You know, we have a sort of, you know, a blueprint for how we might look at Islamist extremism. You know, we have the prevent strategy, and that does work on both thematic areas as such. But is there anything specifically we should be doing for young people, or indeed older people, that's specific to the far-right that can be tackled, you know, in isolation, different to how we tackle Islamist extremism?
So I left Life After Hate just over a year ago, but in my time there, there's one case that really, really sticks out, and it was a former soldier. I think he'd been in Iraq or Afghanistan. He'd seen his friends blown up, and he was really, he called us and he was saying, like, I'm thinking about doing harm to the Muslim center near me. And this, it was really, really on the edge of duty to report. And so two of our team flew, we just said, you know, can you hold on 24 hours? And they flew out to see him and spent a day with him. And they called the imam from that Muslim center and told him the situation. And he was, you know, very busy man. And he said, well, you know, I can give you 15 minutes. And so they went down there with the guy, and he'd never met a Muslim. They were always sort of, you know, the dehumanized people from his experiences. And the imam approached him with compassion. And that meeting wasn't 15 minutes, it was 2 hours, and they were both crying and hugging. And that guy has remained connected and volunteers at that Muslim center. And that compassion piece is so important in helping people come back from that place, because if the source is their self-alienation, their toxic shame, their internal dehumanization, what's their toxic shame? What's the cure for that? And what we found at Life After Hate over and over and over again is the cure for that is compassion. Compassion heals when we rehumanize the person. So of course we have to deal with the ideology at some point, but at the first time we sit down with someone, you know, people say, well, what do you say? It's not so much what to say. It's about listening. It's about hearing the grievance. And the intuitive thing people always want to do is they want to get into a battle with the person's ego and try and win with intellectual arguments and data and that kind of thing. And the challenge is identity and ideology become intertwined. And so in order for you to win that battle, you have to defeat their ego. And nobody likes to sit in a room and deal with that. So our strategy is we go in through the heart, because the ego doesn't really have defenses to that. And so we listen to people, and often they've never had a chance to be listened to. Politicians don't seem to listen, and they've never had a chance to air their grievance. And for whether right or wrong, their grievance is real to them. You know, grievance is a very subjective thing, even if it's coming from a misplaced sense of entitlement. And so it's once you get people, once you allow people to be vulnerable in a space and express themselves without fear of judgment, the walls can come tumbling down, and we can and build on that real human connection, because that's what's missing. Is this real human connection? And we go out into the world and we try and find that human connection in a variety of ways. Because we listen to someone does not mean that we agree with them. So there's our executive director, Sammy Rangel's got a great saying, never concede, never condemn. So you never concede your values in the interaction, but you never condemn them for expressing them either. And it's holding that space to just allow that vulnerability to happen, and compassion when it's combined with healthy boundaries and consequences. And that really is where the accountability piece comes in. Compassion without healthy boundaries and consequences it can be quite weak, and it can be easily abused and that. But when it's combined with healthy boundaries and consequences, it's something that is quite powerful. And it we've helped, I'd say before Charlottesville, we'd helped 100 people, and it was all people that were in the far right wanting help. Since Charlottesville, Life After Hate's helped 500 people, half of them families looking for help with a loved one or a family member, and the other half were individuals that are seeking to, you know, get themselves out of the mess. You know, it's they have to process the things they've said and seen and done, and you know, it often requires counseling and therapy. And Life After Hate's hired professionals. We started off just six of us with the best of intentions and the lint in our pockets, and now we've been able to get funding and hire professionals to provide that counseling service, that healing. And without that healing, I was still a jerk. I was still mean, even though I'd left the movement. I still had this nasty streak to me because I'd never dealt with any of the stuff that made those choices seem like the right thing to do at the time. And so that healing component, healing the emotional wounds, is critical.
Yeah. And that's really interesting because, Kaylin, your work now focuses on granting safe spaces for people to talk about their far-right ideologies. My question to you in relation to the work you're doing now and your experience within the far-right is, if one person now is watching this who is grappling with far-right ideology, what would you say to them? You know, where does it have to stop? When does it cross the line into extremism? And the second thing I want to ask you is, you know, since we've announced this this event going forward, we've had a lot of people online who actually, you know, for all intents and purposes, have been trolling yourself. And I have seen that, and I've witnessed people doing it to you. What do you say to people that don't believe that you can come back from far-right ideologies and, you know, renounce your far-right views like you did?
So to begin with, I started Future Freedom because there didn't really seem to be any other groups in this country that were dedicated to getting people away from far-right ideology that weren't overtly left-wing. And assuming that if you walk away from that stuff, you now need to become a leftist, you now need to join Antifa, you now need to hate Britain, and you now need to do all this sort of stuff. I mean, it's just going from one extreme to another. After Charlottesville, after Christchurch, where 50, you know, Muslims were killed in a mosque in New Zealand, I realized that there was genuinely a crossover between people that were watching and believing and listening to the Great Replacement sort of content and far-right content like that, who were talking about, you know, white people becoming a minority and sympathy to terrorism and this sort of real-world violence. And so I felt like also there's a huge number of people that watch all of this content that become sort of obsessed with it, that lose their family, that lose their friends, that become isolated. When we launched, so that's why I basically launched Future Freedom, because I was like, I want to basically provide a space where people can come and tell their stories about walking away from this stuff, or people that want to come and decide, you know, how best for them to walk away from that stuff and say, I did it and I'm happy now. I've lived a normal life. So is this person. I've teamed up with Samantha, whose partner co-organized Charlottesville, who helped build Identity Europa, which is a really, really right-wing US-based website. And she's walked away as well, and she's lived a happy life. She's managing a bar now. And it's just about showing people that you can walk away from that stuff and everything can be fine. And people that believe that you can't change, that you can't walk away from this stuff, I just fundamentally at a core don't believe that. I think especially young people change their minds about things in a lot of ways. And especially when you're faced with real world events that completely contradict what you're about, there's a really reasonable explanation for that. I mean, there's a lot of people who genuinely just watch this stuff and believe in this stuff because they feel like to be a British nationalist is to be a bad thing, or they feel like the media is too left-wing, or they feel like free speech is under attack. And those concerns and those views are completely valid. I'm not left-wing. I understand a lot of those views as well. But it's about providing a space for people to walk away from the extreme ideology, which is, you know, the Great Replacement stuff, the stuff that borders on sort of sympathy to terrorism and on borders on mass forced deportations, which the Daily Stormer and sites like that advocate for, and pulling people back to a place of stability and normality. You can vote conservative, that's fine. You can vote for Labour. That's also fine. You don't have to go from one cult to another. You don't have to go to the far left or the far right. And we're also tackling far left stuff as well at some point. We would love to have people come on board who joined far left groups that ended up engaging in violence. And because those things are just as problematic. We were attacked with Tommy outside McDonald's in a car park a couple of years ago by some far left extremists. That drove me to the right more than anything, really. And that's just as toxic. So I feel like it's about bringing people back to a center that's just more stable, that's not dangerous, that's not harmful. If people don't believe me and don't trust me, that's fine. I'm not doing this for acceptance or for approval. I'm doing it because it's working. We've had hundreds of people reach out from the Proud Boys, from groups in the US that have seen the stuff that happened at the inauguration or seen, you know, violence unfold in front of them that say, I don't know what to do and I don't know where to go. I don't want to join the left and I don't want to be hammered. Because people are hammered when they walk away. The media don't give them a space to be able to talk. You guys are doing that for me today, and that's amazing. But a lot of people want to throw them aside and say, well, once a Nazi, always a Nazi. Once far right, always out. And it keeps people in the far right, and it's incredibly dangerous. And so that's why I speak out against it. That's why I talk about this. I'm not making profit from it. I'm not making money from it. I'm literally doing it to reduce the size, the physical size of the far right, and it's working. We've got hundreds of people reach out to us all the time. And if you're trolled by people, I think it just proves more that I was in a bit of a cult. I was in a group that no one has, you know, families in those groups. Everyone is about, you know, it's this obsession with loyalty, this obsession of loyalty to their leader. And if anyone is to deflect from that or walk away from that, well, they're a hideous traitor. They should be, you know, locked away. They should be discredited. I had an incredible amount of lies made about me when I walked away, saying I was a left-wing infiltrator the whole time. I worked for the government. I stole money, all of this sort of stuff. And it really shows how toxic those circles really are. Because it relies purely on that, you know, core of we must not ever be countered. We must not have anyone speak out against us. And it's a really bad place to be in. And I'm still friends and I still know people that are inside those groups that I was involved with before. And the main reason they say that they don't leave is because no one else has done it before, walked away and been able to live a normal life. And they're terrified. And that needs to change. That's why we're doing it.
That's brilliant. That's really insightful. Just with regards to my final question for both of you, drawing on, you know, both of your experiences, ideally, maybe if you could speak first, Tony, with regards to the US, you know, everything that's going on at the moment in Canada. What do you think the trajectory of far right extremism is? You know, what is that trajectory? Is it getting worse or are we just waking up to it? Is it something that, you know, is going to get worse, or is it something that's going to sort of plateau and just continually be a reactive kind of force when we're confronted with Islamist attacks?
I think it's in the United States, it's definitely it's much more than the initial concerns with Islam, and nothing happens in a vacuum, right? You know, I don't believe, you know, Trump just spontaneously happened. Trump was a symptom more than Trump was a cause. And nothing happens in a vacuum. So you'll find that as radical elements of the left in the United States want to transform U.S. society, there will be reactionary forces that want things to stay the same, that will rise up to meet them. So these things don't just operate by themselves. They quite often operate in reaction to something. And I think depending on how society reacts, you know, particularly to the, you know, for example, what the violence and everything that happened at the Capitol building, you know, it could get better or it could get worse. If you remove people's political voice, it will get worse. If you turn the country's intelligence services on its own population, it will probably get worse. And it depends on it exists in an ecosystem, and it depends. There's so many moving parts, but I think it will get worse. And you know, look, what happened at the Capitol building was criminal, and everyone should be criminally prosecuted for what they did there. However, you know, people were calling it a coup. Myanmar is what a coup looks like. If you had 400 Oath Keepers fully kitted out in that Capitol building, it would look very different. you know, they were back to finish the votes 3 hours after it began. It was whatever it was, you know, it wasn't right. But we have to make sure that we don't go overboard for political purposes in condemning too many people for something that not everyone participated in, and calling it something that it's not. So I see the United States, absolutely, it'll be getting worse. I see the extreme left getting worse. I see the polarization. It's like a tornado happening on the left and the right, and it's rapidly consuming the middle as these tornadoes grow. And my concern is that it won't be too long before the middle's gone.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, fundamentally, I also think that the main reason that we haven't seen a massive vocal physical manifestation of all of this stuff is because of lockdown, is because of the pandemic. Everybody is at home right now. Everything is becoming accelerated. There's been lots of studies that have found there is a direct link between time spent online and radical ideologies, you know, growing. And it's extremely worrying because it's illegal to protest right now and it's illegal to go out on the streets. We don't see any of this. And it's going to be, you know, the lockdown has accelerated everything that we've been seeing happening over the last 2 years. And we haven't even begun to really understand what the impact is going to be. You know, there's been Senate hearings about all of this stuff to try and understand it. And some of the judges and some of the policymakers are openly saying that they don't know the difference between a tweet and an email. So it's like, how on earth are we even going to start even understanding what's happened for the last few years, and even understanding the damage that's happened and the amount of people that have gone down a rabbit hole, maybe people who are completely lost, people that have gotten worse and worse, and people that have been drawn to extremism. So it's I think it's really worrying. I think it's getting worse and worse, and it's also being driven underground. It's a difficult double-edged coin with this stuff, you know, with censorship, banning people like Milo, banning people like that. You know, I have sympathies in some ways because of their behind the scenes thoughts, but also it's just driving people underground and it's making things harder to monitor. I always believe that sunlight is the best disinfectant for ideas like this, and being able to counter it and be able to put an idea online and have people from the left and the right talk about it, but pushing them onto platforms like Parler and Telegram is just going to amplify the echo chamber times a million. So I think it is getting worse. I think it's not growing, but it's becoming, it's not growing in size as the far right, but it's growing in terms of its intensity and its
covert tactics are becoming more heavily utilized. And yeah, certainly, you know, it happens with prescribed Islamist groups as well. The minute you sort of stamp down on them, prescribe that group, they sort of splinter out underground, and then it's hard to kind of trace and track where they're going and what they're doing. And I'm just going to turn now to a couple of the audience questions, because we've had quite a lot. We've had quite a few questions focusing on, obviously, both of you have talked about compassion and kindness and giving people time and the safe space to talk through their issues. And it kind of goes back to a question I asked you previously, Tony, about, you know, we've had a lot of people ask about people that join the Islamic State, you know, should we utilize the same tactics of compassion and kindness towards these people? You know, can people that, you know, Shamima Begum, she's all over the news at the moment, you know, she's denied entry back to the UK. Should we also be using these tactics on Islamist extremism as well?
Well, I think, you know, again, it comes back to compassion with healthy boundaries and consequences. You know, I can't speak to her as an individual, and I will say that Islam presents an added intricate layer of complexity with the Quran that has to be disentangled, because it's not like everybody's right wing. Some are just really, really right wing and violent. It's whereas there's nothing wrong with being a very devout fundamentalist Muslim, you know, and so it gets a little tricky and nuanced there. And I think you really need a sophisticated approach to help untangle the mistruths that they've learned about Islam. But I think if we give up on the ability for people to be redeemed, if we give up on humanity, I think as a society, we're in a far worse place than if we at least try and make it happen, but put the proper safeguards in place. I'm not saying, because we've had a beautiful, compassionate couple of sessions together, you're, you know, free to go and do whatever you want. You know, the we have to make risk assessments and all kinds of things, but the only chance really for redemption is through the rehumanizing process. And if we give up on that, I think as a society, that's not a good thing.
I completely agree. I mean, it's one of the reasons the right grew so much over the last few years is because of this phrase that I always use today, which is the left look for traitors, the right look for allies. I mean, they were incredibly opening and welcoming to people that were walking away from left-wing groups or people that were even communists that had sympathies for free speech, and they were very, very accepting. It led to the growth of that stuff. Whereas on the left, I think there's a huge amount of problems with being able to accept that someone had those views and could walk away from them. But the only thing that that benefits is the far right. The only thing that that benefits is the far left and Islamist groups. If we have a society and an ecosystem that doesn't allow people to walk away and allow people to disengage from that stuff and go and live normal lives, then those groups will just grow stronger and stronger. It's like The Walking Dead. It will just get bigger and bigger. And unless there's an environment that can deal with it, it's just going to keep growing. And with Shamina Begum and people like that as well, I mean, it's a difficult question because obviously it depends if they've actually been involved in violence, if they've actually been involved in murders or real world killings and things like that. Obviously that should be put before a court and before a judge, and the law should be applied and things like that. But beyond that, if they're genuinely remorseful, she was 15 years old when she joined this stuff. And we have to remember that the same tactics that ISIS used is also that the same tactics that a huge number of far right groups use, which is production value. Inspire magazine is incredibly good quality. It looks like Vogue. It's beautifully put together and it's very, very enticing. The people pushing that magazine and pushing ISIS at the time, who were recruiting mass numbers of people from the UK to the Middle East, were also calling for community. They were saying, we're under attack from this ideology, from Americanism and X, Y, and Z. And it offered them that safety. And it also looked appealing through its production value. So I think it's about looking at that as well. And understanding the dynamics that led to someone believing this stuff, and actually how it could happen to a lot of people. There are people who were involved in the stuff that I was involved in and who had the same ideologies as that was referenced in the shooter at Christchurch, that were doctors, that were lawyers, that were teachers. This isn't a very specific small number of people. This is a massive, ever-growing thing. And unless we can allow people to deconstruct it and to walk away from it, it's only going to keep growing. So it's fundamental that we have these conversations. That doesn't mean you can be involved in something violent and dangerous and walk away scot-free and be happy and live a normal life. Of course, there needs to be, you know, there needs to be counseling, there needs to be therapy, there needs to be law applied, there needs to be conversations about all of that, and remorse as well. But to not allow that to happen is very dangerous.
Yeah, I always think of it as like a disease. You know, if you don't study the pathology of a disease and how it spreads, you're never going to, you know, if you don't bring these people back and understand how they got to where they were out in the Islamic State, for example, into far right groups, you're never actually going to understand how to prevent it. A couple of questions we've had are circling around the subject of Donald Trump. And I want to kind of ask both of you, and it doesn't matter who answers, I'm open to both. What do you think the impact of Donald Trump has been on the far right movement? And secondly, just on the back of that, Alex Stoner has asked, do you have any thoughts on the place of QAnon in the far right movement?
I mean, Donald Trump is not someone that accelerated the far right or anything like that. I mean, 50% of Americans voted for him. He's not an extreme candidate. He was the Republican frontrunner. I think a lot of people, including the media, and this is one of the failings of the media, call all of Trump supporters racist, which is ridiculous. A huge number of people that voted for Trump because they were left behind by the Democratic establishment, left behind by the left and the right, and they were growing up in towns and cities that had all their jobs outsourced. And they wanted something that was counter-establishment and wanted something to put a middle finger up to the establishment. And I don't think that that's a serious problem. But what he did signify was that society is moving forward further to the right, and that there is more of an acceptance of radical ideologies. You know, some of the stuff he talked about with the Muslim ban and things like that. The fact that Americans basically were willing to accept that on the right, moreover, is worrying. And I think it shows that there is a pendulum shift further and further to the right. But he himself hasn't accelerated anything. He was a symptom of that growing and brewing ideology that had been coming up also because of internet radicalization.
Like I said, he's a symptom, you know, not a cause. Much so, you know, like Brexit was a symptom. And I think, you know, I think really what empowers a bunch of Trump's voting base is the way he's treated by the media. I think the reaction to Trump alienates so many people from the quote unquote mainstream or the establishment views. I think the sort of demonizing anyone that supported him, I think absolutely makes his base bigger and stronger. And you know, for 4 years of the constant attacks and vilification, and I'm not a Trump supporter, you know, he got 10 million more votes in the second election than he did in the first one. You know, it didn't weaken him. It made him stronger. And so we have to go back and rethink about what are effective tactics to deal with a growing ideological non-establishment political parties. And those can happen on the left and the right.
And just in relation to the QAnon movement, do you think Trump's departure will signal a sort of dying down of that movement, or do you think that movement's here to stay?
It's going to continue growing. I mean, Trump leaving isn't really going to do anything except mean that it's not as centralized as it used to be. Everything used to be centralized around a common denominator, which was the MAGA movement. That's just going to become more and more fractured, and it's going to become more and more fringe, and it's going to become more and more into sort of tribal groups and hidden on the internet, and it'll still be just as much of a threat. It's more fractured, but it's still growing in its size.
I think we have to look at, you know, how QAnon becomes popular and the ideologically driven news, which ignores obvious facts that everybody knows about or reports on something that maybe doesn't exist. The, you know, with the politically motivated news leads people to distrust the news. They're not getting the news. They're getting political spin. And when people are alienated from mainstream news sources, which they're increasingly becoming, then people seek out alternative opinions and understandings. So I think there's a lot to answer for in how so many people became alienated from mainstream news, that we have to, nothing happens in a vacuum. And we have to look at cause and effect.
We've had a couple of questions. Thank you. We've had a couple of questions from anonymous attendees asking about when do my right wing views become far right? Which is one question. Whoever wants to answer that is more than welcome.
I mean, it is actually fairly simple. I mean, believing in free speech, believing in controlled immigration, believing in British nationalism and the family and things like that are not far right. A lot of people think that. I think those things are far right. I believe in those things myself. I'm still a centrist or I would vote conservative, right? It's not about that. It's about if your rhetoric crosses over with real world violence in terms of sympathies to that, you know, the shooter at Christchurch mentioned the Great Replacement. If you believe in the Great Replacement, then you're believing in an ideology that can technically lead to real world violence. If you believe in Holocaust denial, if you believe in, you know, extremist ideas like that, that have led to synagogues being shot by the far right. If you believe in mass deportations of Mexicans from America, then you have similar crossovers to the shooter at El Paso. It's quite simple. It's do your views cross over with the views of people that have committed real world violence? It's as simple as that. It's not about demonizing Trump supporters and people that voted for Brexit. They have nothing to do with this. It's a very, very, very specific and identifiable thing.
I would say, it's problematic when there is the implicit or explicit promotion or acceptance of violence and wishing to deport a certain class of people, that's implicit violence. So dehumanizing other people on the basis of their faith or whatever, that's, you know, I think if when it comes down to violence and dehumanization, that's when these ideas become very problematic. The challenge is they overlap with other non-problematic beliefs, and we tend to throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Thank you. Another question we've had is, what impact does being involved in the far right have on the people around you? How did your families, obviously, Tony, you said you were a single father in the 90s. What impact does it have on your family? And in the way that, in the same way that you renounce your far right views, you know, do they welcome you back? Did your families welcome you back and your friends?
That's a great question. My dad was, my parents are both English. My mom's from St. Helens, my dad's from Liverpool, and he was bombed by the Germans during the war. And so it's an interesting way to be angry at your father, to have a poster on your bedroom wall of the guy who sent the bombs. The relationship with my father never fully recovered. I don't have much of a relationship with my brother. My mom, I have a good relationship with, you know, and she gave me, you know, if my kids gave me my first lesson in compassion, my mom gave me the second lesson in compassion. And she, the door was always open, and her love for me was unconditional, but her relationship with me was very conditional. And as a young man, single father with two kids, I needed her help and assistance to raise these children. Shout out to great moms everywhere. But she put leverage on me at a time when I was vulnerable and I was half in, half out of the movement. And so she applied great healthy boundaries and consequences around her assistance and sort of leveraged me sort of out the door, so to speak. And so my relationship with her is great. And my kids, they know my history, but they know I'm not my history. And I have a great relationship with my two children and a grandchild. And, you know, as I did the healing work myself, as I rehumanized it, it changed the relationships around me. Like it, you know, you can't have a good relationship with another human being unless you have a good relationship with yourself. And as I built that relationship with myself, the relationships around me all vastly improved. Sadly, not so much for my dad and my brother.
The family thing is really difficult. I mean, there was multiple reasons that drove me further and further down the rabbit hole. One was being attacked violently by far left groups like Antifa, which I still massively oppose. But one was being completely isolated. Like my family did stop speaking to me for a long time. They thought that I was involved in this crazy extremist stuff. They would Google the names of the people that I was working with, and the names would call them far right, and they were terrified about it and really worried about it. But I think that's why it's quite helpful about what we're doing now with Future Freedom, is we understand that actually people can be pushed way, way, way further and way more isolated, because the first thing to happen in a lot of these instances when people start to watch these videos or talk about these subjects is isolation, is the fact that your families will cut you off, and that will accelerate things massively. There's no one around you to give you counterpoints to say, well, actually you might be wrong about this or right about this. You become your own entity roaming around the internet, and things get worse and worse and worse. But it's a difficult thing. Now they're reconnecting more and they're coming back again. But it's only when you leave and you look back do you realize how fringe and extreme the stuff you were involved in really was. Because at the time, I didn't think I was far right. At the time, I didn't think I was racist, none of that stuff. I was literally like, I'm an openly gay person. I'm going around Britain and we're fixing things and we're going to do things about free speech. And it felt completely safe. But actually, under the surface, from the outside, it was far more dangerous.
And the one thing I'd just quickly add in there is there's nothing more dangerous than someone who has nothing left to lose. And there was a period when I was completely estranged from my family, and that was probably the period where I was the most extreme.
Brilliant. That's been really insightful, both of you, and I really appreciate you joining us today. And thank you to our audience as well, who sent in a lot of questions. I hope we gave you a good, well-rounded sort of view of the far right, all the way from cultural nationalism, all the way up to, you know, white supremacy and neo-Nazism. So thank you for joining us, Tony and Kaylin. Thank you so much. It's appreciated. You know, we've had a lot of viewers today who really appreciate what you've been saying, and the feedback looks great. So thank you very much, and take care.